Hi. In this tutorial, we will look at the new ramp editor introduced in Mavic Cinchpack 6R2. The ramp editor adds full gradient editing capabilities to Mavic, a feature that was missing previously completely. With many convenience features such as color picking sequences, as well as a full preset system preloaded with gradients for use in environment and character work, hopefully this editor will be one of the most comprehensive gradient solutions you can find in any application. You can find the ramp editor in the Node Graph right mouse click menu under the Edit submenu or by pressing Ctrl and R. However, for it to open, you need to have the right node type selected. Apart from one exception, the editor works by modifying a node's curve attributes. Currently, four nodes are supported for direct editing. The brightness lookup node has a single value curve, so you can use it to edit grayscale values. The color lookup node allows you to work with red, green, and blue values simultaneously. The best node to use with the ramp editor though is the RGBA lookup node, which has an additional alpha component that you can utilize within the editor. All of these nodes can be used within group nodes, materials, and custom procedurals. So by exposing their curve attributes from, let's say, inside a material to the outside of a material node, you give yourself the possibility to edit the material directly with the ramp editor, which will recognize the exposed curve attribute. One exception to the curve attribute only rule is the gradient map node. The gradient map was Extension Pack's previous ramp approach, allowing you to control a maximum of 8 color keys. When editing such a node, the ramp editor will dynamically activate and deactivate the available color keys. However, of course, you will stay limited to a maximum of 8 keys, which is probably another reason you might want to use the curve nodes, which do not have a key limit. Okay, so let's start diving into the editor's functionalities. Let me create an RGBA lookup node here to colorize this terrain's height map. Select the node and press Ctrl R to edit the node in ramp mode. We get a visual representation of the points of the curves, and just by modifying the ramp, the points update interactively on the node and as a result on the model as well. You can always pause this interactive update by pressing this pause button up here, or pressing space or the H hotkey. While honestly, even on complex ramps, I never had to pause the node update, it can speed up the interactivity of these sliders a bit when having dozens or hundreds of color keys. While I instantly see any changes I make in the ramp editor on my model, all of these changes live in Mavic's history under a single undo entry. So when the ramp editor opens, a history entry is created and it remains active and records changes until I press commit changes. This has the positive effect that I can cancel the dialog and my curve node will go back to what it was when I first started editing it. However, it also means that any Mavic action I do while the dialog is open lives also under this single undo entry. So you can see here, if I navigate with the dialog open, all those navigation entries are still part of the ramp editor undo entry. And if I cancel the dialog, then my view also snaps back to what it was before the dialog opened. Within the ramp editor itself, you have a full undo and redo stack, supporting up to 200 steps. So while it is open, you can undo individual operations using Ctrl Z or redo them using Ctrl and Y. Next, let's go over the interface a bit and we will start with the general gradient interaction. As you would expect, I have the usual controls such as clicking into the gradient to add a new key, and down here I can slide my keys around either individually or all selected ones. I can also do multi-selections by dragging a rectangle selection, and then with shift click I can add additional keys, or shift and drag to do an additional selection rectangle. With control and drag, I can subtract or simply control click on individual handles. If I have a range of keys selected and I want to condense my selection to just one of those selected keys, I can double click the key or drag a new selection. We also have some hotkey options for things that are not exposed in the UI. If I do a key selection and press and hold hotkey Q, then I can scale the key positions up and down. If I press and hold hotkey D, then I can evenly distribute the keys. If there's no selection, then these operations work on all keys between the positions 0 and 1. For denser RAMs with a lot of keys, this standard view might be a bit hard to navigate, which is why there's the option to zoom into the RAM. Here to the left and right, we have the zoom control buttons, and their names correspond with the hotkeys that is assigned to them. So if I do a selection here and press hotkey plus, I will zoom into the gradient, with the selection being the zoom center. Once zoomed in, I can use arrow left and right to pan around within this zoom level. To reset my view to the default, press this R button or the R hotkey. We also have a frame selection option on F, so this will directly maximize the view to the range of my selection by zooming into it. All of the options and hotkeys on the gradient are documented directly in this tooltip in case you forget. Down here we have some options that usually work on the entire gradient, such as selection tools like select all, select none, and invert selection. All with standard hotkeys assigned. The select duplicate positions is a convenience tool to select keys that sit directly on top of another key, so keys that share identical position values as another one. Delete all, as you would expect, is a total reset. Desaturate is a convert to luminance. And invert colors takes the opposing color. Mirror keys will mirror the position of the gradient bands and is the odd one out of those top row actions, as it can also work on just a range of selected keys. Lastly, we have clamp, which limits values to a 0 to 1 range when applying it to the node you are editing. Within the editor, everything always stays at full range, so you can freely toggle this on and off. Next to the mirror button, we have this drop down with copy-paste key functions. This one is designed for you to be able to transfer positions of keys in between different ramp nodes. Let's say I have my RGBA lookup node here, responsible to create a diffuse color. I have a second RGBA lookup that is meant to control the specular roughness and should have identical key positions but different values. Using the copy key functions, I can copy the keys from the color ramp to my roughness ramp while only transferring the key positions. The paste function is clever enough to be able to detect only changes in positions and allows you to auto-create keys that are missing in the target ramp or use only existing keys. Down here we have our color controls, which act differently depending if you have one or multiple keys selected. If you have multiple selected instead of an absolute value, your sliders are zeroed out and you are adding or subtracting values from each key. In addition, with multiple keys selected, an extra contrast slider becomes accessible as well. Sliders have some nice features to control their stepping. Number one being a Houdini-style increment ladder on the right mouse click, giving different fidelity when dragging. And number two, the standard Mari behavior of placing your cursor into the value field and using the up and down arrow keys to control the decimal to the right of the cursor. With a single key selected, these color buttons next to the sliders act like a regular color picker, just a more lightweight version than the main color picker here. If we have multiple keys selected, the color fields act as a tint mode, so that means that the value picked here is multiplied against the value of each key. The U value is the only one where an addition is made, instead of a multiplication, so you can push all selected keys through the color spectrum. The key-specific buttons shadow some of the top row buttons, such as invert color to gray and the delete button, except that they work on your current selection. Copy-paste to copy colors between keys. And finally, the pick color option. Pick color allows you to pick a color anywhere on your screen, even outside of the Mari window. You can see on the cursor that the color space dynamically changes depending on where I am. So here I am picking within the gradient's color space, here I am picking raw unshaded colors from Mari's viewport, and here I am in sRGB screen space. We will talk about color space at the end of this video, but for now just know that you can switch this dynamic color space mode up here in the color space options to something else. Apart from the single color picker, we also have the sequence eyedropper. With this one, you can just pick a whole range of colors in one go. The precision slider is a multiplier against the number of dots that appear on your screen when you use the eyedropper. So 0.5 would mean every second dot is ignored, while at 1, every dot will generate one color key. By default, the sequence eyedropper will insert into the full range of the gradient. But with the limit range button, I can force it to only insert the result into a certain area. So if I select some keys, do a eyedropper sequence, then this new sequence gets inserted just into my selected range. We skipped over the reduce keys function up here, which can also be handy in the case of these eyedrop sequences. Basically, it will look at each key's neighbor in color and remove it if it's within the threshold set by the slider. If I move the slider to the right, then the evaluation is done left to right. So we always compare against the key to the right of another key, and right to left if the slider is negative. Once I release the slider, then the keys are deleted. We talked previously about the built-in undo system. Another way to go back to a specific ramp look is to use the snapshot button up here, which will save the current state of the gradient. The snapshot button is mapped to Ctrl and S. Snapshots only live within your current project and can be accessed via the presets up here. So here under the categories, I have a project snapshot folder where all my snapshots are listed. To go back to one, either press the apply preset button down here, press hotkey A, or double click on it. To delete a snapshot, press that minus button here. While snapshots are project specific, you can of course save normal presets as well. If I just click this plus button, I will get my gradient saved into the user preset category. You can make your own categories over here if you want more granular control. As soon as I add a gradient, it is automatically tagged with color names, so you can more easily search for them. You can see the color tags for that gradient I just saved down here. We can edit these tags with this dialog, where you can enter whatever helpful search terms you want. To remove a tag, just click on the button. We can also edit the auto color tags and add and remove them, or use the color picker to sample a color and the dialog will figure out the next closest standard color to apply the tag name from. If you want to favorite an item, press the heart button or hotkey L and it will appear as a shortcut in our favorites category. This can be quite useful if you like something from one of the default extension pack categories. We have a lot of out-of-the-box presets pre-filtered by color category. To drill down further, you can use the tag search, for example, to only list everything that has gray and red in it. The search is similar to other extension pack search fields where you use comma as or, plus for and an exclamation mark to exclude something. So here we are searching for something that has gray and red in it while not having any yellow. Alternatively, anything with green is also allowed since we are comma separating the term green. I can also do global negatives using a minus. So here I'm searching for gray or yellow. However, I want to exclude any greens. So instead of adding an exclamation mark green to both terms, I can just do minus green as a separate entry and it will act like a global subtraction. If I just want to experiment a little bit, you can use the random selection button up here, which is on the hotkey S, and just select a random item from the current category. However, I would like to see the result of my random selection immediately in the viewport. So for that, I will click this auto apply button down here, which will immediately push the active selection into the main gradient. And if the node update is not paused, this will then also automatically show up in the viewport. Let's talk about those options up here next. First, we have samples. The samples slider is only active when within an extension pack standard category and is disabled when, for example, you have created your own user preset. The reason for this is that for memory conservation, all of extension pack's presets are saved as 512 pixel wide image files, while standard presets you yourself save are stored as files with coordinates. So these extension pack presets don't have any color key data anymore and instead allow you to set how many color keys should be created based on that saved image. Next, we have the crop action, which, as the name suggests, allows you to crop the presets to a specific area. You can toggle the crop on and off with this button or Alt and C. Below the crop, we have the insert options. This is similar to the limit range of the eyedropper tool, just that it works on presets. So I can set a range here where I want to insert a preset, or choose to get the range from my selection. To wrap this up, let's talk about color spaces. As shown earlier, we have all our color space controls up here in this menu. The node source color space is the color space the curve node's existing data is in, and the ramp editor on opening then takes that data and transforms it into its own working color space. Usually this input color space defaults to Mari's own working color space, such as linear for a standard OCIO file or ASUS CG for an ASUS color config. The output color space is then the target space the ramp editor transforms its data into when applying the results to the node. Usually input and output color space should be the same. The output color space is stored onto the node, and the next time you load the ramp editor with the node selected, the input color space will auto set to what was used as output before. So let's change this to raw, apply the changes, and reopen the ramp editor. Now the source color space automatically switched to raw because this is the format the node's data was last applied in. Next we have the scalar toggle. This acts like the scalar button down here in the view transform toolbar of Mari, but only applies to the gradient editor display. So it is a pure visual change that does not affect any of the internal data. So in color mode, we apply the color data LUT set in your view transform bar. And in scalar mode, we apply the scalar transform. You can also toggle this directly in the main interface with the button down here. We have the option to link this directly to the state of your Mari viewport by pressing this link button or double clicking on this button here. Now, whenever the Mari viewport LUT changes from color to scalar or the other way around, the ramp editor will keep in sync with this. So this was kind of an in-depth overview of the tool. A lot of information I also put in the quick tips, which you can cycle through by clicking or pressing F1. And of course, everything has tooltips. Thank you for listening.